Okay, we're going to get started. And I just want to welcome everyone. And just to give you a little bit of background in who I am, my name is Eli Gelardin. I'm the executive director at Marin Center for Independent Living. Marin Center for Independent Living is a 35-year-old nonprofit here on 4th Street, and we've been serving and advocating for people with all types of disabilities to live independently in the community and have choice. So the genesis of this forum and why we're here today is really to talk about how we can make Marin accessible for everyone. Some of you might know, about the Americans with Disabilities Act, but this conversation is really broader than that. It's about our community. It's about aging in place. It's about accommodating every disability and looking at disability as part of a spectrum of abilities as opposed to, labeling one type of disability. It's also about customer service and providing an environment and a community that offers the best customer service for everyone. Not just a person in a wheelchair, but, an older adult, a family using a stroller, someone with dementia or memory loss. So this forum came together through a collaboration of some fantastic people and organizations, and I just want to recognize them very quickly. Carol with the Downtown Business Improvement District, Carol Thompson. Joanne Webster with the San Rafael Chamber of Commerce. And Stephanie Lovett with the City of San Rafael Business Development. Yes. Also, I want to recognize this space is really open. I want it to be a safe environment to ask questions, come to a common understanding. This isn't about being fully accessible or not fully accessible. This isn't about pointing fingers. This is about having a dialogue and creating an environment that, we feel comfortable asking questions and we can come to a common ground and common understanding. And lastly, I want to thank Richard Kalish, who I really blame for developing this whole concept, but really bringing the community together to have this dialogue. And we're going to introduce Eric Holm, who is with Guide Dogs, volunteer Guide Dogs for the Blind?
Actually, I'm president of the state board for Guide Dogs for the Blind, so we're the state... Jonathan's here. So we do all of the oversight, regulation, policy, licensing for all the guide dog instructors and schools in the state of California.
Thank you, Eric. And Eric is going to talk to us about his perspective as a advocate and a customer and a resident of San Rafael. So, Eric, would you like to come up over here and I'll pass you the mic?
Sure. Thanks.
I think the captioner can't hear you.
Bring my better half with me.
Okay, Eric, here you go.
Oh, very good. Thank you. So I'm Eric Holm, and this is my better half, Ford.
Ford, can I sit?
Yeah, we're on, so be good.
Okay, lie down.
Good enough. Thanks. So let's see, in addition to Guide Dogs for the Blind, I'm also on the City Park and Rec Commission and also on the City of San Rafael's ADA Advisory Committee. So I like to wear a lot of hats in the community and just be a part of everything we do here. So I grew up in Marin and specifically in Tiburon and San Rafael, and I make San Rafael my home now. And it's just a very comfortable environment for me involved in politics and social activities and the business community. So I know a lot of you already, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here. I guess from a disability perspective, as a consumer, and I'm an excellent consumer, disabilities are kind of what you make of them. So I think when you're a vendor or you're running a business and a disabled person comes in, I like to think that I'd be treated the same way any of your other customers would be treated. And I understand that, you know, there are certain limitations and expectations we all set on one another. But I think the main thing that we want to do is to have a mutually beneficial transaction when we come in to do business together. So, you know, whether that's me going to one of my regular shops, which is the baseball card store or Safeway or any of the numerous restaurants. By the way, I mean, you know, I eat out at least once a day, usually three times a day. My favorite thing to make for meals is reservations. So, but it's interesting because when you walk into stores, I find that some vendors can be very uncomfortable with a disability. You know, they're not familiar. It's something different. And some people react badly, and not meaning to. So perfect example of this was I went into a restaurant 2 days ago with my friend Dean. I won't mention which one, but the maitre d' was very nice. And I walked up to her, and I said, hi, table for two. And she looked at my friend Dean, and she said, is he going to require a table or a booth? And I said, excuse me, I'm right here. And she said, well, I'm talking to him. I said, well, I instigated the conversation, you know. So it was just that kind of thing, you know. Or if you go into a store, you know, and you say, I'm looking for thus and such, and they just sort of point somewhere, and they say, well, it's right over there. And it's like, over where? So there's a lot of common sense things that I think can be easily overcome with just a little bit of thought and concern. There's a story. Well, I was actually in Macy's last weekend, and there was a big sale going on, and everybody was very busy, and we couldn't get any service. So I looked at Ford, and I said, I need your help. So I picked him up, and he's kind of big, and he's about 76 pounds, and I got him up on my waist, and I picked him up and slung him over my shoulder, and I pushed him up into the air, and I got him on his leash, and I started swinging him around. And so the clerk comes over, and she says, can I help you? I said, no, just looking around. Okay, I just want to make sure we're all awake. Thank you very much. Next show's at 11, try the veal. So, and we have a number of tip sheets on our website, and that would be guidedogboard.ca.gov. And we have partnerships with both the hospital associations, restaurant associations, and hotel associations on sort of best tips and practices for sight-impaired people and people with guide dogs in particular. It's much broader spectrum, of course, but that tends to be my main thrust for obvious reasons. I brought along a little video that we did for the Restaurant Association. Basic things like when a sight-impaired person comes into the restaurant, you know, you talk to them, you know, specifically. You know, you don't talk to the dog, don't talk to the other person unless, you know, they initiate the conversation. Basic tips along lines of, mobility and, for instance, if you're a server, if you tap the table and you say your table is here, you know, so it gives you a sound clue as to where it is, or they can tap the chair so you know where to sit. Okay, sure. And do you want to do questions and answers afterwards? Or no? Okay, perfect. All right, then I will turn this over to Carol.
Thank you very much.
President of the State Board of Guide Dogs for the Blind. Our board licenses and regulates guide dog schools and instructors in the state of California, ensuring that instructors are qualified, training is standardized, and schools are well managed. As part of our efforts, we provide information to consumers, partners, and stakeholders on a variety of important topics. One of those topics is restaurant etiquette. When a guide dog team, the guide dog user, and guide dog enters into a restaurant, the goal is a successful business transaction where the team leaves as a satisfied customer. To assist in making the transaction a smooth one, we have compiled some best etiquette practices.
Welcome to Group
goodness. Thank you.
I see you have a dog with you.
I do indeed.
Is this dog a service animal?
Yes, this is Ford, my guide dog.
And how has he been trained to assist you?
Ford has been trained to understand numerous commands, and he and I work together as a team to get around safely.
Very nice. Ford's a beautiful dog. Can I show you the table?
Please.
It's straight ahead of you.
Hello, I am the server. And here's our menu. Okay. Can I assist you with the menu?
Yes, please, if you would. Could you tell me about the burrito section?
Sure. We have a chicken, a steak, or pork burritos.
I would like the grilled chicken burrito, please.
Got it. I'm going to place a glass of water on your table at 3 o'clock.
Okay, thank you very much.
Wonderful. Plate this Mexican from in advance at 12 o'clock.
Very good.
Seven words on the table at 9 o'clock.
Very good, thank you very much.
Enjoy your meal.
As you can see, the restaurant etiquette tips are useful to ensure a smooth business transaction takes place both for the customer and the restaurant staff. Whether you are a restaurant owner, hostess, or server, please keep these tips in mind next time a guide dog team enters your restaurant. For more information about these tips, or to learn more about the California's State Board of Guide Dogs for the Blind, please visit our website and connect with us on social media, www.guidedogboard.ca.gov, or find us at Facebook, California State Board of Guide Dogs for the Blind, or at twitter.com, California Guide Dog Board.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Eric. And we're going to have a panel after all the speakers have an opportunity to give their presentations to do a Q&A and ask follow-up questions. I'm just moving my phone that's serving as our captioning, live captioning device. So just to give you, you know, kind of a context of the format of what we're doing, we're going to, you know, start with kind of an overview of the ADA and some of the basic non-architectural steps that a business or a property owner can make to make their business more accessible. Then we're going to have a discussion around readily achievable barrier removal, it's a mouthful, and some of the more technical terms of around access and architecture. And then we're going to have a legal discussion and talk about legal implications, landlord and tenant, and lease agreements. And then after we have all of our speakers, we're going to have a panel and a Q&A for everyone to ask questions and continue that dialogue. So our next speaker is Jan Garrett. Jan is a good friend of mine. She is currently employed by the Public Health Institute in Oakland, also known as the Pacific ADA Center. Jan has a distinguished career in disability services and advocacy. She's the former director of the Center for Independent Living, the country's first independent living center in Berkeley. And she is a lawyer, and she is a longtime advocate. And in her spare time, she is on the board of Access Dance, which is a disabled and non-disabled dance troupe out of Berkeley and Oakland. So give her a hand, and Jan, come on up.
Okay. Should I come over here?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay, great. I also don't want to block the captioning, so I'm going to try to be somewhere where...
How about right here?
Okay, Jonathan, can you see the captioning
yeah,
behind
yeah,
me?
Thank you.
Okay, so can the captioner hear me?
Yes.
Okay, that's good. That's good. Okay. Well, I just want to thank Eli and the San Rafael Business Improvement District and, you know, everyone who is responsible for creating the day, for inviting me here and for allowing me to talk a little bit about Pacific ADA Center and a little bit in general about what businesses responsibilities are with regard to the ADA and how people with disabilities can be an excellent asset to you by purchasing your goods and services and making sure that, you see that people with disabilities aren't just people who stalk you and sue you, but are also people who come in and enjoy your wares and you know, actually provide you with an excellent community and a full diverse community, which I think is important for all of us. Frankly. So I wanted to be able to talk a little bit about that today. So next slide. So as Eli said, I'm from the Pacific ADA Center, and I think you all will be able to get a copy of our brochure in the back, and people will be able to get a copy of this presentation, I believe. So you'll have our contact information. But I want to make clear to people, particularly the businesses in the room, but really anybody, we serve people, anyone with rights and responsibilities under the ADA, the Rehabilitation Act, the Fair Housing Act, any number of disability civil rights laws we give information about. So people can call us after our presentation today, anytime between 8 and 5, Monday through Friday. You can call us as many times as you want. Please believe me, we have people who call us every day and ask us questions, and you can ask specific questions, and we can give you technical assistance about, you know, different aspects of the ADA, including architectural issues and lots of other things. So please utilize our services. We are also getting into the area of doing surveys for businesses. Unfortunately, we do have to charge for them, but it depends on the size of your business. And there also may be ways, I think Eli will talk about later, that businesses can get some money to pay for, you know, those surveys as well. But the technical assistance is always free. So please utilize that as often as you like. So next slide. So who are customers with disabilities? So under the ADA, a disability is you know, an impairment, a physical or mental impairment that limits one or more major life activities. And that can be speaking, hearing, cognitive functioning, and vision, and any other mobility, any other major life activity. Okay? And in the ADA says substantially limits major life activities. California says limits. So California is broader in terms of the state law, okay, in terms of covering people with disabilities. Also, people with disabilities do face obstacles in the world. So it could be in the built environment, it could be communication obstacles, it could be policies and procedures, and it could be fire and life safety, it could be any number of things, including transportation. So there are many, many barriers, and what we have to do as a society is look and to see how we can eliminate those barriers and improve access for everyone and improve people's ability to spend in your businesses. Okay? So the buying power. 18% of Americans, or about 51 million people, have one disability or sometimes multiple disabilities, okay? And this means that there's a strong disability travel market, as well as, you know, people who, Eric was talking about, people who eat out, people who shop at local stores, people who do all sorts of consumerism. And so the average number of leisure trips and hotel stays by adults with disabilities has increased by 50% from 2002 to 2007. Okay, so there's a big disability travel market. And then, as well, potential customers with disabilities have 220 billion, that's billion with a B, in discretionary spending power, and spend 13.6 billion annually, okay, on average. And that's across the United States. But that's just people with disabilities spend that amount of money. So it's a big, important part of the economy. And so it's customers with disabilities are yourself, myself, almost anybody in this room. Whether you have a disability now, you may later. You may have family members who have disabilities. You may have friends who have disabilities. The important thing to realize is that customers with disabilities are potentially anyone. And you don't want to let that market go. And really excellent customer service is what everyone wants, whether they have a disability or not. So treating people with respect and dignity and offering them the best possible customer experience is the best thing you can really do. So some general requirements for businesses under the ADA. So public accommodations is what the ADA calls basically private businesses, okay, that are open to the public. And that can be restaurants, shops, any type of business. And you're, as a business, you're required to ensure that your goods and services are accessible to and usable by people with all types of disabilities. So that's kind of the general requirement. And you can do this by removing barriers. And that might be a physical barrier, you know, like a doorway that's too narrow. It also might be a communication barrier by learning how to use the relay service that's offered for people with hearing impairments. It might be a barrier for someone who has a vision disability. So there are, what you need to look at is how you can remove barriers for people to participate in your business. Okay. Also, to provide equal opportunity, you need to have the equal opportunity to benefit from the goods and services that are being provided, and that's a general ADA requirement. Also, the ADA prohibits discriminatory denial of services and benefits. Just like under the Civil Rights Act of 1964, I think most businesses now know that you cannot exclude a person of color from your restaurant or store. And by the same token, the ADA is a civil rights law. And so it says you cannot exclude people with disabilities from your store or your restaurant. And so it actually, the ADA is derived from the Civil Rights Act of 1964. And a lot of people don't realize that. So a primary goal, as we spoke about, is equal opportunity, equal participation of people with disabilities in the mainstream of society, and that includes integrating people. So in other words, not putting people with disabilities all at the same table over in the corner of your restaurant so that other people don't see them, making sure that, you know, people have the right to be integrated within your business, that separate programs might be permitted in certain instances, but the person with the disability gets to choose about whether or not they're going to participate in the separate program or participate in an integrated program or services. So also, individuals with disabilities cannot be excluded or required to accept special services, as I just said. And so it doesn't guarantee that people with disabilities get the best experience. It guarantees that people with disabilities get an equal experience. So a lot of times people will call and say, I have to stand in line at the grocery store. And I say, welcome to the club. The ADA didn't say that you get to go to the front of the line. The ADA says you get the same crappy service that everyone else gets. That's what the ADA guarantees, is the same service. Not better, not worse. The same. So that's what people, you know, need to understand. It levels the playing field. Okay? And so for an example, an individual with a wheelchair may not be excluded from an exercise class because they cannot do all the exercises. They need to be able to do what they can in the way that they can do it, and be able to be integrated into the regular exercise class. Now, if you have a specific, like, wheelchair yoga class, people can choose to take that if they want, but they're not required to do that. So that's an example of an integrated program. Okay? Another general requirement that's important to know, once you have accessible features, once you have this great doorway, this great accessible restroom, you need to maintain those accessible features. So in other words, don't put your supply storage in your hallway that makes it narrowed down so that someone can't pass through. You know, don't put something that's going to be a tripping hazard to someone with a vision impairment in the circulation path. You know, don't store your toilet paper in your accessible stall. No, I mean, you think I'm kidding. I'm not. You know, there are a lot of people who do this. So make sure that once you have those great accessible features that you maintain them. Now, a temporary interruption in service, like an elevator that might be down temporarily while you wait for a part, is to be expected, and that's not going to be against the ADA. But you need to fix something like that as quickly as possible in order to get it back up and running for people. Okay? Also, an accessible route throughout your store and from the public right-of-way and into your store or restaurant is very important. Making sure that if you have merchandise that the aisles are wide enough, that there is at least a main path that people can get through. If your store is simply too small to do this, then you need to do what's called an alternative to barrier removal and bring things to people so that they can see them if they cannot maneuver all the way through your store because it's just simply too small. But you need to offer some other way for people to be able to access your goods and services and not simply throw up your hands and say, I can't do anything, my store is too small, my store is too old, there's nothing I can do to comply with ADA. It's actually not true. There is a lot you can do. Okay? And you have to make reasonable modifications to your programs and policies and services as well to make them accessible. So next slide. So if, for example, modifying the policy that says, I don't allow pets in my store or restaurant. Okay, but you might have to modify that policy to allow a service animal or a guide dog. So that is an example of a modification of policy. Another one might be, I, for example, don't have a driver's license, and there's a lot of people out there that are happy about that. But I do have a California identification card, okay? So if I go to buy something and I present a credit card and somebody says I need to see ID, that California identification card that I stood in line for 15 hours at the DMV to get is just as good as a driver's license, and they cannot require me to have a driver's license. They need to modify that policy if that's the policy that they have, okay? So that's important to understand too. So another example is an individual may have to still wait in line to get something, but you can offer them a chair and note where they are in line and then let them come up when their point in line when they're up to their point in line where they initially were. So that's another modification that you can offer. You also have to be sure that communication is as effective for people with hearing impairments as it is for other people. And you're supposed to talk with the person with the hearing impairment to figure out what is that form of effective communication that's going to be best and consult with each other and figure that out, whether it might be passing notes for a short conversation or for a longer, more complex conversation, you may need a sign language interpreter. But for a brief transaction in a store, usually an interpreter is not going to be necessary. Okay. So auxiliary aids and services is what I just talked about, exchanging notes and providing interpreters if it's necessary. So the ADA also requires businesses to ensure that their facilities are accessible and usable in the built environment. So new construction, renovation or additions, existing facilities. And Arfi is going to talk about this in just a few minutes, but businesses have to remove barriers where it is readily achievable to do that, to remove barriers. And that's basically, you look at your budget and your profit and loss, and you determine what barriers need to be removed, and you make a priority, and you make a plan. And you determine what you can do in year one, in year two, in year three. And Arfi is going to talk a little bit about that. So you don't have to do everything at once, but you can't, again, just throw up your hands and say, I can't do it. There's nothing I can do. There are many, many, many different things you can do, and you do need to make a plan. Again, Pacific ADA Center, we offer technical assistance, training, materials, and please utilize our services, and we thank you very much for inviting us here today.
Thank you so much, Jan.
Okay.
And again, we'll have an opportunity to ask questions and get into more details after all of our presenters have gone. So next up, as Jan alluded, is Afarez Kambada, okay, and or commonly known as Arfi. And Arfi is with Sally Swanson and Associates. He's a certified access specialist, and he's an expert on assessments of facilities for compliance with the ADA and ADAG, also California Title 24, and other relevant access requirements. And as we discussed, he's going to get into some of the more detailed, readily achievable barrier removal. Don't say that too often early in the morning. It's a mouthful.
Good morning, and thank you for having me here. And I'm really glad to see such a big turnout here today. My name's Arfi Kambada. I'm a certified access specialist, as Eli mentioned. And I've been tasked with talking about readily achievable barrier mitigation, some of the facts pertaining to the regulations and standards around Title III entities, such as public accommodations and places of business. Moving right along, in terms of, I guess I'll start with the CASP assessment. Who needs a CASP assessment? The CASP program was put into effect by the state legislature. Any private company that owns, operates, leases or leases to any kind of public accommodation can avail of a CASP inspection. What a CASP, and these are examples of the various kinds of public accommodations that we have. A CASP survey essentially allows you to identify physical barriers within your built environment, barriers to goods and services that you offer the public. It allows you to document those barriers and then develop a work plan to mitigate those barriers. And that kind of leads us into the readily achievable barrier mitigation that Janet alluded to earlier this morning. The work plan provides you with the ability to A, document your good faith effort of mitigating barriers in a readily achievable fashion. It also provides you with a document, let's say you do get sued, to take to court and show A, your good faith effort, what you've accomplished over the past few years, and your plan looking forward. So who's responsible for ADA compliance in leased places? We get this question a lot. A lot of small business owners aren't aware that their landlord has an equal responsibility too. The US Department of Justice has come out pretty clearly to state that. Landlords have an equal obligation. Although having said that, it does go back to what your lease agreement with the landlord is. So if there are any landlords in the room? Okay, so it does depend on your lease agreement with your between the two parties. A lot of times it's good to have an inspection done up front, perhaps before signing the lease, so everyone gets into some kind of an arrangement with their eyes open, knowing what needs to be done. And landlords could, I've seen in some instances, they'll include the cost of barrier mitigation and what's the word, prorated over the course of the lease. So that way, their tenant is now in an accessible space, and they are not out of pocket either. So it's a win-win, if you will. If you could go back, just one, sorry. I think I covered that, so moving on. What does the term readily achievable mean? So readily achievable is plainly and simply something that's easily accomplishable and able to be carried out without much difficulty. Clear as mud, right? All right, that's how it was intended to be. readily achievable means different things to different business owners. Depending on the kind of business you are, the means available to you, perhaps you're going through a slump in your business and the low-hanging fruit, if you will, need to be even lower for you to grab onto them. Whereas if you're a larger organization, and you can potentially address physical barriers that may require tens of thousands of dollars, and those might be deemed readily achievable to that kind of business. In determining whether an action to make a public accommodation accessible would be readily achievable. The overall size of the business is one factor to be considered. But the ADA also permits consideration of the financial resources of that particular business and requires that a business has a continuous obligation for providing disabled access, so the more difficult work must be planned and performed. And while this can be done at a later date, as Jan alluded to in her presentation, goods and services still need to be made accessible by alternate means. So what are some of the readily achievable examples of readily achievable solutions? So changing a door lever, for example, that's could be deemed readily achievable. The round knobs that you see on some doors, those are hard to grasp and require twisting of the wrist, so they're not deemed accessible. The lowering of a telephone or a restroom accessory, those are readily achievable, easy to do. Installation of grab bars where it's not cost prohibitive to put in the backing to allow for the 300 pounds of pressure, that could be readily accessible too. Next slide. So when is a restroom with public access required? We get asked this question a lot, and typically, if you have an accessible public restroom is required for existing businesses built prior to the 1998 California Building Code. When an indoor dining or services area is provided within the business or facility, or the business provides medical facilities. In small retail or food service businesses, employee and customer restroom facilities can be combined, but larger facilities generally require that there be separate employee restrooms and public restrooms. A small food preparation facility that exclusively provides carryout services is only required to have employee restrooms in most jurisdictions. And all new construction requires accessible restrooms for public and employees. What does a business on the second floor need to do to comply? So a couple of things to take into account here. First of all, is there an elevator available in the building? If not, can the same service or goods be provided at the accessible level, an alternative means of providing access? Examples may include home delivery of goods and services, or coming to the door to receive or return said goods or services. Such services should be clearly displayed and easily identified by the disabled customer upon arrival. So signage. Providing some kind of signage to let the customer know what they can expect. So what are some of the common mistakes that we typically come across? These are some examples from businesses in the San Francisco area. With the slopes that we have out in San Francisco and even here in San Rafael, a lot of times just getting in the front door can be an issue, and it's pretty hard to address that without coordinating with your local jurisdiction. So here's an example where the door doesn't have a level maneuvering space. If a person in a manual wheelchair is required to operate a door, or pull it open or push it open, there's a requirement that there be a level floor space. A level means with a slope no greater than 2% or 1 in 50. Any kind of step or threshold exceeding half an inch is also considered a barrier. If you have more than one entrance and one of them is accessible, provide the required signage to the accessible entrance at your non-accessible entrance. Next slide. Here's another example of a door hardware that's not very accessible to folks that either don't have digits or can't necessarily don't have the ability to grasp and then use their thumb to pinch down to open that door. So service counter, this is probably the most common thing that you come across here that's required in a public accommodation is an accessible service counter. If there's a requirement to have someone sign a credit card receipt, or perhaps they have use of just one hand and they take their wallet out, place it on a counter to then take the money out of their wallet. If they're in a wheelchair, it needs to be no higher than 28 to 34 inches per the California building code. The feds allow 36, but since we're in California, we're special. We need to be a couple of inches lower than that. Non-compliant restrooms. Restrooms tend to be the hardest or barriers within restrooms tend to be the hardest to address just because of constraints of space in existing facilities. In this particular example, I know the picture's a little grainy here, but it's clear that there's not enough room to make a transfer onto the water closet. There are no grab bars to for someone to support themselves while making that transfer either. And overall, there's not sufficient room in this restroom. The knee clearance under the lap, the height of the mirror, and the dispensers. And you can't see it in this picture, but the insulation on the hot water pipes and the drain pipes is missing as well. The knobs on the faucets is another thing to look out for. The basic rule of thumb in terms of what is accessible operation of any hardware, like a door hardware or a faucet, is can it be operated with a closed fist operation. So if you have a U-pull, you can potentially, with a closed fist, put your hand in and pull the door open. If you have a lever on a door, you can, with a closed fist, push it down and either pull or push the door open. In the case of those faucets, you have faucets that can, again, be just operated with their fist. So another common mistake, as something that Jan mentioned, we commonly see restrooms being used as storage rooms. Well, so even if you have the required space and you've installed the accessible features, it's important to maintain those accessible features. And by maintaining those accessible features, you got to maintain the clear floor space requirements, be it in restrooms or corridors. Next slide. So what are some of the top 10 mistakes? I'm going to breeze through this. I was going to do it David Letterman style, but that's not going to happen. But I don't have any disabled customers. You hear that a lot. Well, there's a reason for that, right? There's a huge population out there who want to come in and access your business, make your business accessible. I'm grandfathered in under the ADA. The term grandfathered in is something that's commonly used by building officials because it pertains to the California Building Code. There are various editions of the California Building Code. It keeps changing every 3 years, 6 years. And if you've done some work under, let's say, the 2001 CBC, you don't necessarily need to upgrade your accessibility features under 2007, or the current one is 2013, unless you do an alteration project. I'm in a newly constructed building, so I should be good, right? Well, not if your furniture layout impedes access to wheelchair users or has hazards protruding off the wall for individuals who cane users. Can't afford to comply. Well, you can't afford not to, right? As Mark will probably talk to in a few minutes. My landlord says no. Well, as we discussed earlier, There's a common obligation between landlord and tenant to provide goods and services in an accessible setting. I'm uncomfortable offering assistance to customers with disabilities. Again, something that we talked about earlier, and that's just a personal thing one needs to get over and recognize that good customer service needs to be offered no matter what. I wasn't aware of the legal requirements. Just because you're not aware of the laws of the land doesn't give us a free pass. So that's what today is about, getting us aware of our legal obligations, seeing what we can do and how we can do it to make our businesses more accessible to persons with disabilities. Service animals, that was addressed in the previous presentation, and the ADA standards keep changing. Well, the ADA standards, the 91 ADA standards were recently updated, and there's safe harbor provisions for certain items that were under the 91 standards. So if you, let's say you lowered your light switch from 60 inches to 54 inches to comply with the 91 standards, with the new 2010 ADA standards, it's required to be at 48. Well, you don't need to lower it again. This is, of course, not taking into account the California Building Code requirements, but just from the ADA point of view, there's safe harbor within the new ADA standards, the 2010 ADA standards, and nobody else complies. Why me? That should have been number one. But I just want to thank you again for the opportunity and. If there are any questions, feel free to come and swing by and ask.
Thank you so much, Arfi. Okay, so we're going to go right up to our final presenter, and it is Mark Rice. Mark is an attorney with McNeil, Severa, Rice, and Wiley. His legal practice focuses on business litigation, corporate transactions, real estate and construction, law, human resources, and dispute resolution. He's been in our community since 1986, practicing law. Give Mark a hand.
Thank you very much. That's okay. You don't need to applause for a lawyer. Okay, so I grew up in Mill Valley. My parents still live in Mill Valley, and they're at the point in their early 80s where they're starting to say, we're having trouble going up the stairs. And so when I was thinking about today's talk, I was thinking about my parents and the changes. And there, my mother was a surgical nurse for 35 years, so she's very open about anything medically, sometimes too open. But I realized that this 51 million is going to become 251 million because of the great health care and better living habits we all have. We're all going to live longer, and we're all going to be disabled for a number of years in our lives with limitations that require access. And so I think the leadership of this group, I applaud all of you here for doing this because it's a changing landscape. Where I get involved is I represent businesses, hopefully on the early side when they're negotiating a lease with a landlord-tenant or starting a construction project, and not when they get a notice that there's going to be a lawsuit filed. And that happens. And the law is set up that the state of California has outsourced enforcement of ADA by public policy because they think it's cheaper to all of us as taxpayers to do it that way. And so it becomes, for those businesses that get sued, they feel like a speed trap, okay? Right? We all know what a speed trap is. We're all speeding. We're going 70 miles an hour, but they're hiding and they grab the one person. We feel it's unfair even though we're speeding, right? Well, the way businesses feel sometimes it's unfair is because unlike a speed trap where the CHP gives you the standard $300 ticket, the person that pulls you over gets to decide how big the ticket is. And the longer you argue with the ticket, the bigger the ticket gets. And that's the sort of the confounding part. But in my material, I've included a letter from Dianne Feinstein quoted to the California legislature's assembly leader 2 years ago, Daryl Steinberg, and his response to just to reflect the controversy within the legal community. And it did result in some compromise legislation that created the CASP designation and some safer harbors for businesses if they really want to be proactive. And I think, Jan, your comment, plan, it's about planning. It is about planning. And I just had a recent case in Santa Fe where the architect had passed away, but during the process of the lease, there were plans prepared and submitted to the city of Santa Fe with ADA compliance. And it wasn't compliant when the patron went in, and I've known the attorney on the other side for many years, and we were able to establish, without having to pay attorney's fees, that, look, we were in process, okay? And then I brought in a CASP, and we did mainly grab bars. They had a second floor that was going to not have an elevator. So that's an example of being proactive. And I think my experience, especially if you get to know the folks that file these suits, is if you've established that you're one of the good guys, you're really trying, and you're in the process, you catch a break, okay? And the biggest issue is always, the going rate of these cases, attorney's fees, the agreements generally are confidential, but the ranges are well over $10,000 in attorney's fees, sometimes 20, 30, for the cost of removing a lawsuit, plus the retrofit, which the landlord and tenant have to negotiate. So it's kind of a complicated situation. Grab bars, I would just say this. Grab bars and all those things that are, those are critical, because those are all readily achievable and not complicated, and they're sort of low-hanging fruit. Bathrooms are big ticket items. But if there's structural barriers, I've seen the ADA, what we call the plaintiff's bar, fairly amenable to doing what you can if there's a structural wall and the kitchen equipment's right behind, okay? Ramping and signage in the front is critical. And I'll give you this little example. Just working with a landlord tenant in a lease extension, and they got sued. The tenant had gotten a CASP report, didn't print it out years ago, and didn't share with the landlord, and all of a sudden there was an ADA lawsuit. Just terrible. Poor planning. So we have to deal with the aftermath there. But once the retrofit was done outside, it allowed for kind of a rethinking of flow for everybody, and the landlord put out some nice benches, and now it's become this sort of almost like Walnut Square, Pete's Coffee, sitting area where the community is enjoying a space. So a lot of times the accessibility actually brings an opportunity for everyone to reevaluate how to have a better mousetrap. So I would just say, businesses, especially in this economy, are challenged on every possible level, and this is just an area where you want to be vigilant. And I think really just thinking about how a accessible person would navigate through your business if you do that. Now, I'll share my little epiphany. There's a guy who's passed away now, George Louie, and he was one of the first guys to do this. He used to be a bouncer, okay? He was a bouncer. He was a very colorful guy, and there's a lot of cynical comments about him, but he would got to the point where he would call the opposing attorney, and he would just literally go over rat-tat-tat all the things that were wrong. He was an expert in his own way, and I represented a winery space up in Sonoma, a beautiful place. I've been there many times. And they had a barbecue pit, and they had gravel, which was their way of, to the walk-up, which was their way to avoid the grease. They would rake it so the grease would kind of get. And I just remember sitting there, and this might have been my 10th or 12th ADA lawsuit on the defending the business. I said, sensitivity demands that if I, of all people, understand that, because I've been here so many times and I'm trained in knowing that. So I think a lot of these issues can be dealt with by being sensitive to the disabled community and the needs of access. And my experience is when you're into a dispute, if you are genuine about that, it helps get it resolved immediately. And the toughest conversation I have is always with a newly immigrant family-owned restaurant barely with English as a second language and limited, and I have to explain that the barrier of the ice, you know, maker and on the way to the bathroom has created a discrimination claim against them. And they're floored that by not affirmatively excluding somebody, like the civil rights was initially intended to, that by not removing a barrier, by not doing anything, they are being accused of discrimination, they who feel maybe they are discriminated against in their lives. So those are tough calls, and you just have to say this is how the law works in California, and the faster we can deal with it, the better. So two little things. For those that are landlord or tenants, I would really suggest that you do not just sit back and sign the standard form lease that has this nice warning at the bottom developed by the broker community. It's really so brokers don't get sued. It says, warning, ADA law is out there, it's going to bite you. That's all it says. I mean, it doesn't really help anybody. And what's happened is building officials, and not in Arfi's case, but many architects, landlords and tenants are so scared of the ADA because they think it's mysterious that they shy away from dealing with it. You know, I personally think that building officials, when you do a permit application, should have an ADA list of current requirements, because I think if they did, there would be a lot less problems. Some jurisdictions currently, I'm told, you know, want to see 10% spent on ADA, but that really doesn't address the legal issues, because it's not how much money you spend, it's whether or not you've effectively removed obstacles. The other thing I suggest is that landlords and tenants do get a CASP, a specialist, like Arfi, ahead of time, because then you can do that plan. You can say, this year we're going to do the ramp. When we remove the, when we update the kitchen equipment, we'll deal with the bathroom. We're going to do the knobs immediately, and you bring it into the same way you would with tenant improvements. And let me tell you, that plan, it might not be a get out of jail free card, but it's close, because it says you're on your way to do something as opposed to putting your head in the sand. I like a very specific ADA referenced language in a lease as an addendum that just says who's going to do what, and I drafted that and provided that to you. It's my concoction. It doesn't fit everybody, but it does impose one. Once you have that, you can't sit back. You've got to take steps. So that's really all I have to say, unless there's any questions. It's the way I would say it is, I was thinking on the way here, when the Golden Gate Bridge was first built, if you think of ADA as a construction issue as opposed to accessibility issue, workers didn't wear hard hats, right? Workers did not wear hard hats. There were probably some resistance from the guys about wearing hard hats because, you know, it was a new safety paradigm, okay? 20 years ago, before a lot of refinery problems, there wasn't the kind of drug testing there is today. A construction worker has to go on, they have to have spot drug testing because we don't want problems. Think of how important that was to life safety for those families. And so I think with ADA rules, if we think of them as safety rules, as public policy about our basic democracy of inclusion, but also good construction, it takes sort of the debate about it, is it good business or bad business? It's just the lay of the land. And I think that organizations like this and the city, I know I'm very thankful to be here, do the right thing to put on a forum, you know, to hear about how to deal with it. So now the one last thing I got to say, there's a case called Del Taco. Okay, so you're going to leave one thing, what am I talking about? Del Taco. Del Taco is an important case because a judge in the Central District of California didn't like that there were lawsuits without a notice provision. And even Clint Eastwood fought tooth and nail to put in a notice provision into the law because he thought it was unfair not to be given an opportunity. And the law doesn't really say you have to have notice, but judges will not award attorney's fees easily unless they feel there's been fair warning, right? Demand letter. If you ever get a letter that's the nicest letter you've ever read from a customer that wasn't happy about something, a friendly letter that says, gee whiz, I was in your store, had these problems, that letter needs to be addressed immediately. because it looks like just a nice letter, but it has been carefully crafted to tag all the important things. And I have seen this happen twice. Tenant didn't give the letter to the landlord. Some would say, cynics would say, that it's drafted specifically to satisfy the Del Taco judge concern, but to not actually engender a result, because the result would then exclude a certain part of the legal profession from the benefits of these lawsuits. I don't know if that's true or not. Nobody said that to me. But I have seen instances where the tenant either does nothing, doesn't give it to the landlord, certainly doesn't involve a lawyer, doesn't involve a CAS, and sometimes they try to jerry-rig some kind of ramp and creates more problems for themselves. So be aware that if your customer is making an issue about your bathroom, your ramp, your doors, or access, and describes difficulty, it has to be treated as if your building is now on fire. Okay, I say this when I deal with harassment claims. If there's a harassment claim, it's like if you had a worker that had a serious injury, you'd stop everything and you bring in all your risk managers and all, right? But then what happens is we have these other issues that fall into other areas and we don't treat them seriously. Treat it seriously, and I think you'll find that your disabled patrons will appreciate you, and you might find out that all these changes really make for better access across the board and a more enjoyable human experience. So that's my question or comments if anybody asked anything.
We're going to go into a panel.
Okay, perfect.
Thank you, Mike. Excellent. So we are going to go into a panel discussion. I wanted to do a few housekeeping items. One, we have flash drives by Maddie at the sign-in sheet. They have all the material we've gone over today, all of the PowerPoints and presentations. There is also additional info on links to other access checklists. It's all available for you to take that flash drive home. The other item, Stephanie, you want to introduce Richard?
Thomas Ahrens, who's our chief building official in the city of San Rafael. So he's here also to answer questions when the panel is going.
Excellent. So questions. And I'm going to repeat the questions for our access purposes. Yes.
Yes. What assurances are there that recently permitted work is in compliance?
Great question.
You want to repeat the question?
Hold on 1 second. Let me bring the...
Yes. Okay. Okay, so this comes up quite a bit, which is the fact that your work is permitted does not mean that if it doesn't comply with the law, you get a hall pass and not change it. No different than if you built a building that didn't have enough clearance or any other construction defect, it doesn't immunize you from a problem later where the buyer, purchaser, or user says, you got to fix it, it's not structurally sound or whatnot. There is under the new statute, what's called Civil Code Section 55.56, a reduction in the potential penalty. It's $4,000 per violation, which is defined as each visit by a disabled patron not achieving access, not each individual problem, so that's good. It goes down from $4,000 per violation to $1,000 if when you got your building permit, either the building official or you had a CASP report and you met the report and you didn't make any later changes. So to me, of course, most building departments won't have CASP and they're not going to venture out to do that work. If you're retrofitting anything, you're going to get a CASP because it's like buying an insurance policy. $1,000 to $3,000 to do a CASP, depending on the size of the building. They look at the plans and say, those plans meet current ADA standards. Now, you know, depending on their conduct, they're at risk to you, the builder, the owner. That's the best way to get a safe harbor. There is not even technically a safe harbor if you've been sued and settled because you negotiated with one particular patron what they'll accept is accessibility, and the next one may say, no, it's not enough. So there, but that's the way that I would do it, is I would get a CASP report, and that usually is enough, but it's not perfect.
Great, thank
and
you.
I would just add to that that when you're looking at a permit project, for example, you could it depends on the scope of that permit project. You could pull a permit to do a small area within your business, and that may not trigger all accessibility requirements. The building inspector or anyone from the building department may come in, and they'll be focused on the area of alteration, not necessarily how you as a business owner provide your goods and services in an accessible manner to the public under Title III of the ADA. So, who scoped your project for you? As the owner, you sit down with your licensed design professional and say, well, here's what I want to do, or here's how much money I have to spend on this project, what can we get done? And together, you come up with a plan. And then that plan is submitted for approvals. You're asking for approvals on the California Building Code for that limit of work, which you and your design professional have determined. The building department doesn't necessarily come in and see if you've met your Title III obligations under the ADA.
Not necessarily.
Not at all. Usually.
Sure, sure. And I think we've got this fundamental...
Just one sec.
Let me bring it back.
All of these speakers have touched on it, but we have this sort of fundamental difference between California triggering mechanisms and the ADA, whereas the ADA says very broadly, you shall make your business accessible, period. California gives us, has a different way of enforcing it in that the discretionary improvements that you create in your business tend to trigger the required upgrade. So when we do look at a project you're doing, much as the example he pointed out, and you're doing only a portion of your business, we focus on that, and then many of you have heard of the 20% rule. Well, California says, well, you're going to do this over here, and everything you do in your proposed discretionary improvements is going to be accessible. In addition to that, as long as you're below a certain financial threshold, you must spend an additional 20% to provide access elsewhere in your business. And that's the limit of your responsibility under the California Building Code. The ADA, on the other hand, says you may still be subject to, never mind what the ADA says, you may be subject to civil litigation based on non-accessibility according to ADA standards.
I have one other comment. Is I do recommend that clients who are doing improvements, when they're getting a permit, think very carefully about asking for a determination of hardship. And not all building officials want to do that, or planning commissions. But if you're doing a remodel and you can establish a true hardship, either financially or structurally, I just think there's a little benefit to the business owner to have it documented. You're going to be subject to a political process, and they may say no, and you may have to do more. You're calling attention to the issue. But I just think it's a safer way to go, and it's a more transparent way to go. So that's what I would do.
And in San Rafael, we will routinely do that. Unless your facility is 100% accessible, we will document what we do and why we do it using this format, which is a disabled access hardship form, to say, okay, this is what we did, this is why we did it, this is what is still not accessible, and we agree to that.
Okay, so let's hit a few more questions before we're out of time. Jonathan, and then Jeff.
Yeah, I understand in the film that in which Eric and Ford were starring that when the restaurant owner came over and asked you about the dog,
yes,
that they're not allowed to do that.
If it is readily apparent as to the purpose of the service animal, then they are not supposed to ask, because it, for instance, the guide dog has the harness, it's a particular type of dog, it's very apparent what's going on. There are service dogs that are not as apparent, in which case it's fine to ask. For instance, a signal dog, right? So if you have a hearing problem, and that's a fully recognized service animal, but if you walked in with a signal dog, the owner of the establishment might not be able to tell what that is. In which case, they're permitted to ask only one, but they're permitted to ask two questions. One, is it a service animal? And then what is the dog's training to accommodate a disability? They can't ask, are you disabled? But they can ask about the dog.
So the second question then, it follows up on that. Does your organization, Jan, deal with a private landlord-tenant? In other words, people renting to homeowners, residential, or do you just do commercial?
No, we cover every title of the ADA, for example, including employment, by the way. So we give people information on that, as well as state laws regarding access and employment, and we also cover fair housing, both at a state level and the Fair Housing Act at a federal level. So we get calls about sort of everything, and probably every day we get two service animal calls as well. Just thought I'd throw that out. But we definitely do deal with residential issues as well, yes.
I would like to address this issue because I actually had a client, a prominent restaurant in Marin County, a traditional restaurant, who had an increase in animals in their business, and they suspected that some of the animals were not service animals because they didn't behave like service animals. And they called and said, what do we do? And it was clear that it was folks that were home during the day and alone and never didn't want to eat alone. They were going to eat out, but they didn't want to eat alone, and wasn't necessarily a service animal as defined by statute. And so we actually did a research, and we found that there's a specific regulation that describes very specifically what a business must do. And then they posted a sign out, we welcome service animals, we welcome service animals managers, please be reminded of the following regulations, and just put out, and that solved their problem, because then those folks that knew their animals were not true service animals didn't bring them in. So that would be.
And just a quick clarification, I know I need to speak into Eli's phone there, but in housing, you're allowed to have companion animals and emotional support animals. Those are perfectly legal under the housing laws. Those are not service animals. Those are not animals that are entitled to be in public places. So there is a difference between a service animal and a companion animal. And sometimes people don't understand that clarification either.
Okay, so we are out of time. So thank you again, everyone, for coming today. And we hope to continue the discussion beyond just this forum, but this is really about a dialogue and an ongoing dialogue between the disability community, the business community, and the larger community, which is really about making and keeping Marin accessible for everyone of all ages. So give the panelists a hand and yourself a hand.